General Ehsanul Haq Sahab, Nusrat Mirza Sahab, ambassadors sitting on the stage, professors, deans, and participants. Assalamu alaikum. मुझे नुसरत मिर्ज़ा साहब ने जब मधु किया था तो उन्होंने कहा था कि आप 15 मिनट आपको बोलना है, तो मैंने बड़ी मुश्किल से पाकिस्तान के जो बड़े गंभीर इकोनॉमिक मसाइल हैं जिस पर मैं एक दो घंटे बात कर सकती थी, उसको बड़ी मुश्किल से मैंने 15 मिनट में अपने आप को मरकूज़ किया है, तो इससे कम 3-4 मिनट में आई थिंक आई विल नॉट बी एबल टू डू जस्टिस, सो आई वुड लाइक टू टेक माई फुल 15 मिनट्स. मैं आई थिंक जी नहीं, बहुत शुक्रिया, नहीं थैंक यू. अब एक चीज़ जो है जो मैं आपसे शेयर करना चाहती हूँ, दैट पाकिस्तान इन स्पाइट ऑफ बीइंग एन एग्रीकल्चरल कंट्री प्रोड्यूसिंग ऑलमोस्ट 1/5 ऑफ द जीडीपी फ्रॉम द एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर एंड हाफ ऑफ इट्स पॉपुलेशन वर्किंग इन द एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर इज स्टिल फूड इनसिक्योर एंड इन स्पाइट ऑफ वास्ट रिवर्स एंड ट्रिब्यूटरीज इज पोर्टेबल एंड इरीगेशन वाटर स्केयर्स एंड इन स्पाइट ऑफ वास्ट हाइड्रो कोल ऑयल एंड गैस रिजर्व्स इज एनर्जी शॉर्ट ऑफ एनर्जी. पाकिस्तान ऑल्सो हैज़ लार्ज मिनरल रिजर्व्स बट प्रजेंट्स अ परफेक्ट टेक्स्ट बुक एग्जाम्पल ऑफ अ रिसोर्स कर्स अफ्लिक्टेड कंट्री. अब इसकी क्या वजूहत है कि हमारे पास हर चीज़ मौजूद है मगर इसके बावजूद हमें हर चीज़ की स्केसिटी है इस मुल्क में. प्रायर टू 1947 व्हेन पाकिस्तान वॉज इन द कलोनियल मोड, its human and physical resources were used free of cost by the British who were the colonial masters, and that is why the industrial revolution in Britain and the Second World War was financed by the Indian treasury and also by using the local workforce. But now we've been independent for the last 70 years and we celebrate our independence with a lot of funfare and we take a lot of enthusiasm in telling people that we are a sovereign country. But in spite of that, our land and air routes, our natural resources, and even our scarce resource such as water are at the disposal of foreign companies and countries who use them with impunity and without paying us anything. And I think this, to my knowledge, in my opinion, this is financial, not just mismanagement, but financial madness. That we have the resources, but we give them out free of cost to many Western countries and some countries in the neighborhood also, and also to these companies, like in the case of Nestle, as was proved recently. But in spite of that, we then go with the begging bowl all over the world collecting money. So this, in my view, is financial madness. Before Pakistan started borrowing from the IMF, it was a prosperous country. In the 1990s, harsh IMF conditionalities and bringing dual nationality holders and those associated with the international financial institutions played havoc with our economy. Our GDP and sectorial growth rates have declined. Skewness in the distribution of income and poverty levels have increased substantially. Public sector institutions have become dysfunctional and rent seeking is rampant. These institutions are unable to deliver the essential services such as primary and higher education, research, legislation, water, power, transport, etc., and other civic amenities to the public. Natural resources are being looted and plundered. Agreements have been signed with foreign countries which reflect Emmanuel's unequal exchange, I quote, unequal exchange in its most blatant form. In some agreements, the share going to the country and its people is minimal, but there are examples when resources have been given at zero royalty rate to our friends. Our highways and roads are being used for transportation of armaments, goods and services to superpowers free of cost. Foreign companies have also been given land and scarce resources like water totally free to make profits, and the very liberal foreign exchange regime facilitates in the repatriation of these profits overseas. Poor governance and corruption are taking their toll, resulting in a sense of exclusion, breakdown of law and order, increase in conflict and turmoil, non-availability of essential services and utilities. The rule of law is non-existent, merit is marginalized, and might is right. Pakistan does not today need to go to the IMF and follow the old trajectory. We need comprehensive reforms in every sector, but not those dictated by the IMF. Going to the IMF would be a very serious blunder at this point of time, because any further decline in the value of the rupee and the resulting increase in debt will be horrendous. Tightening the monetary policy as a counter-inflationary measure, increase in electricity and gas rates will result in massive deindustrialization, decline in incomes and salaries, leading to implosion of the economy as happened in the Soviet Union in 1991. It has been made quite clear that harsh IMF conditionalities will also include political and strategic ones targeting our nuclear assets and CPEC. Pakistan does not have to be held hostage to feudals, Pakistanis on the payroll of international financial institutions, countries, and foreign powers and vested interests. We have talented academics who can bail the country out of the present economic crisis. I have prepared one such alternative and feel that it is not the availability of alternatives, but the lack of political will that is responsible for the economic crisis that we are faced with. Now, I begin with discussing very briefly this IMF alternative to the IMF that I have prepared. But I'll discuss it very briefly because we don't have the time. If you look at the IMF prescription, you see, IMF prescription is all about this concentrate totally on increasing exports, and that also through devaluation. Now, for the last 3 decades, we've been trying to increase our exports through devaluation, but we've not been successful. All that devaluation has done, that it has brought about an inflationary spiral, which we've tried to correct through tightening the monetary policy, through increasing the lending rate. But that and the devaluation, the inflation that has come about, and the increase in gas rates, electricity tariffs, etc., has resulted in massive deindustrialization and massive declines in incomes and increase in poverty level and also in the distribution of income in the country. And the focus of IMF strategy is an across-the-board reduction in imports. They try to reduce all imports, and that is the problem, because when you try to reduce all imports, a lot of the imports are the ones that we need for our economic development. So what I have proposed in my alternative strategy is that I have not proposed across-the-board reduction in imports, but I have suggested a targeted approach where we are going to target only those imports which are non-essential and consumer goods and which are being consumed by the very wealthy segments of the society. For example, I have proposed many times before that we should curtail the import of several luxuries, like, you know, all these chocolates, all these cheese and fruits and vegetables that we import, and all the cars and all the automobiles and etc., all the consumer durables. We should just ban their imports for about 2 years. And so this is the selective demand restraint that I have talked about, that I have proposed in my strategy. And there are certain advantages of this approach. First, we know that devaluation for the last many years has not been able to increase our exports. Second, I have tried to pass on the cost of adjustment to the wealthy segments, and the cost is very minimal. Even if they don't get these luxuries for the next 2 years, there are still so many goods available in the market that they can use and enjoy. And third, the proposed strategy tries to break the trade-off between economic adjustment and economic growth, because what I have suggested is, what the strategy that I have suggested, it will expand the economy. Now, because it will expand the economy, so there won't be any recession or decline in incomes. And I have tried not to increase foreign exchange by increasing exports only, but have focused on expanding exports, reducing imports, increasing remittances, increasing foreign investment and financial assets to increase the flow of foreign exchange. There are so many ways that we can increase the flow of foreign exchange in the country. So we can rely on all those rather than just concentrating on exports. So I have proposed the following measures. I will not discuss them in detail because we are short of time. But the short-term measures that I have proposed are selective demand restraint, banning the import of luxury and consumer goods. Second, importing essential goods on barter. So we don't, for example, oil. A lot of countries, Iran had offered to Pakistan that they can supply oil to us on barter. So these are the kind of strategies, out-of-box solutions that we have to think of. Then third one is securing better deals for the supply of goods and services from Pakistan. For example, like I said in my introduction, that we've been passing on all our services and all our very vital passages free of cost. Now we must start charging market rates for the supply of Pakistani goods and services to whoever is, whether it is NATO or whether it is China or no matter which country, but we've got to charge for the use of our services and for the use of our goods. And fourth one is that the foreign exchange regime, we have to bring in some capital controls. And this is the perfect time because all the countries are thinking about their economies, as is reflected by Brexit, as is reflected by the statements coming from President Trump. So this is just the perfect time that we should also be thinking about Pakistan's economy. And then we have medium to long-term measures, which include, number one, exploring substitutes for essential imports. Number two, exploring alternative commodities and markets for exports. Repatriation of looted Pakistani assets transferred abroad and gold reserve management strategy. And finally, implementation of Cartagena protocols and phytosanitary standards. Now, obviously, I have the paper, full paper. If anybody wants, I can discuss in detail. But the details are given. And then, having just stated them, I will then go on and state, I just briefly want to talk about the Cartagena protocols, because if we want to avert the free fall in the export of food, cotton, and cotton manufacturers, we will have to ensure quality assurance of its products. Pakistan is already a signatory to the Cartagena protocols on risk assessment and biodiversity, but we are not implementing that. And that is why we have not passed the labeling law, with the result that our exports have a lot of genetically modified GMOs, which will not be acceptable to 19 countries in the European Union and to the Russian Federation and many of the Central Asian republics. So we have to look into this GMO and try to revert the seed amendment to the Seed Act that we did. Then I also want to talk about governance. I think it is very important, as pointed out earlier by Ambassador Najmuddin Sheikh. I think that is the real important problem that is afflicting us. And the problem is that for the last, I don't know when this system was imposed on this country, that for the last many years, we have marginalized competent people, educated, very competent, patriotic and honest people. When it comes to appointing people on leadership positions, then we look for people who have links with foreign countries, particularly the United States. I think we'll have to abandon this. This is just the perfect time. We need to abandon this and bring in merit and bring people to leadership positions on the basis of merit, on the basis of their qualifications, honesty, and patriotism. It is not important that you should have links with China or the United States or any country. It's important that you should have strong links with your own country, and you should have stakes in the state of Pakistan rather than in foreign countries. Then with regard to public finance, I have a lot of suggestions. And the most important suggestion, obviously, is that we've got to bring in the tax net people and the sectors, wealthy sectors of the economy who are not in the tax net, instead of just increasing the incidence on people who are already paying taxes. And also, we've got to come up with a debt management strategy. Pakistan is so heavily into debt, but we have not devised a debt management strategy. I have one which I'll be very happy to share if anybody is interested. Then on the expenditure side, This is debt management strategy. Then I can skip physical and in social infrastructure, because I think infrastructure, some attention is being paid to development of water resources, and CPEC has also resulted in development of some infrastructure. With regard to agriculture, I would just like to state that because of the genetically modified seeds, our cotton production has declined substantially in the last few years. And now I've heard that very important, very big seed companies have arrived in Pakistan, and they are trying to put maximum pressure on the Prime Minister to allow genetically modified corn and other food products without doing any risk assessment on health and environment. Now, this will be a very, very dangerous thing if Prime Minister Imran Khan agrees to it, because this, I think, will be used, I personally feel that this is being used as a biological weapon against the people of Pakistan, because we are not doing any risk assessment and we are allowing cultivation of GM food products. So this, I would like the policymakers to give some attention to. I have got some suggestions on how to increase organic farming, but I will postpone it till sometime that somebody asks me in the question answer session. I have a lot of suggestions with regard to industry. I have proposed an industry come area specific industrial policy, by which I mean that we should give incentives to industry that uses the raw material in a local area. For example, we should have a targeted approach in Balochistan and KP and Azad Kashmir, all these areas. We should give incentives only to mineral-based industries, stone mineral-based, and fruit and vegetable processing industries. And for the big cities, we can create a dynamic competitive advantage. And I can talk about it in detail if there is any interest, but I have to finish up quickly. With regard to natural resources, again, we should not be exporting our natural resources in raw form, but we must try and convert them in the form of manufactured goods before we bring them as finished products in the country as well as export them. With regard to privatization, liberalization, again, I have points, and I think that I would be happy. I feel that we have to distinguish between strategic and non-strategic assets. And then, obviously, I have many suggestions with regard to how we can improve our distribution of income. But since Mr. Nusrat Mirza has already got up, so I see that he wants me to finish up. So thank you very much, and I'll be happy to discuss details of the paper. Thank you.